with Life Impact Church family. And it means a lot to us. So those who don't know, there's a couple of beautiful new faces. My name is Pastor Teya. My husband and I have the privilege, absolute honor, of being pastors of this amazing, ridiculously amazing church family. So we're going to jump straight in it today. Today I've titled the message, Elements. And because this weekend, you know, I don't want it to be just another Easter celebration where we get to have the eggs, like we've heard, it's okay, we will have the eggs. And we have an amazing 4-day break. As great as all that is, I want more. Do you want more? I want my life to be so impacted by the whole process of Jesus' death and resurrection that when people have an encounter with me or when people have a moment with me of any kind, they think of Jesus. Do I represent Christ? And maybe that's a question you can ask yourself as well. It's like, do I represent Christ? Everywhere I go, the impact I have, do I represent our amazing Jesus? So I don't want this weekend just to go by. I want it to catch my breath. So I need to pause from all the busyness, of all the planning, and just take a breath and just embrace this sacred moment. So at this moment, the world stops. Whether they believe or not, they stop. The reason is because we have a risen King. So for me, you know, I've been thinking about this Easter weekend a few weeks ago, and I wasn't on roster to preach, but it was just a moment in meditation that God really took me to the elements. So the elements that was actually required for this sacred moment that we call Easter. In 1 Corinthians 15, 3-4, it says, I pass on to you what was the most important and what had also been passed on to me. Christ died for our sins, just as Scripture said. He was buried and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as Scripture said. Christ died for us. And I know, you know, we don't like to delve deep into the how he died, because it is quite torturous and it is quite traumatic just to hear and really think about how he actually died. How do we even comprehend such a vile act to happen to our Savior? But without it, without knowing it, the story is incomplete. The story has no beginning, just an ending. The story, his story, was written in history today for us to be able to understand the importance of it. So today, what we're going to do is we're going to look into the three parts of the death and resurrection. The before, the during, and the after. And we're going to look at the significant elements that were necessary to take place. So as you see, I've got a table full of props, a little bit of a visual of these elements that we're going to talk about today. So let's get straight into it. We're going to start at the arrest of Jesus. So Jesus was taken to some very important officials, and while he was there, he was beaten. And then he was sent to stand before some other very important people, the governors. So after getting sent back and forth between all these important people, they were trying to find fault with him. So they decided to appease the crowds, and he was handed over to be flogged and crucified. So you can read about this in the Gospels, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Jesus was mocked. He was flogged. He had a crown of thorns jammed on his head. He was severely beaten. He was whipped. He was tortured. And then he was nailed to the cross. Let's stop. Let's just pause for a moment. What elements were used for this to happen. What happened leading up to the cross was necessary because it was a fulfillment of prophecy. And we can read that in Isaiah 53 and 52. We can go back to 52. It's just some light Easter reading for you guys. While you're on a break, have some homework for you to do. But in verse 3, it says, he was despised and rejected. Verse 5, it says, he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so that we could be made whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. Verse 7, he was oppressed and treated harshly. And verse 8, he was struck down. So the first element, Jesus was beaten and flogged. And I almost want to apologize for being a little bit descriptive, but I don't think I can because it is what happened. But I am keeping it. We do have little children here, so it's not going to be too dramatic and descriptive. But imagine Jesus as he was being beaten over and over and over and over again. Huge pieces of skin and muscle being ripped and torn away with every blow. By the time the soldiers were done, his back, his buttocks, and his legs would have been a bloody, mangled ribbons of flesh, muscle, and sinew. This beating was called the half death, because half the men who received it died from it, but not Jesus. He had to endure more. Can you imagine? There was more to come. In Matthew 28:30, and they spit on him, grabbed the stick, and struck him on the head with it. The next element is the whip. So the Roman soldiers, experts of torture and death, stripped Jesus of his clothes and likely chained him to a stone pillar. They beat him again with a Roman flagrum. So I do apologize if I have not pronounced that right. But it was a whip that would have been from anywhere to 3 to 12 strands of leather. Metal balls were woven into the leather, and at the end of each strand were pieces of broken pottery, glass, nails, bone, or twisted metal, designed to grab flesh and rip. Jesus was whipped 39 times. It's pretty full on. John 19:1, then Pilate had Jesus flogged with a leather-tipped whip. Pretty full on, isn't it? It's crazy. Now we have the next element. It's the crown of thorns. It was twisted together, a crown of thorns with the famous Jerusalem thorn bush, with thorns that were up to 3 inches long and beat into his skull with a rod, which they also used to batter his face. In John 19:2, it says the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. Isaiah 52:14 says, but many were amazed when they saw him. His face was so disfigured, he seemed hardly human. And from his appearance, one would scarcely know he was a man. I think it's painting a pretty brutal picture, isn't it? Next one is mockery. Now, Jesus became an object of mockery. The Roman soldiers knelt before him, laughing, calling out, "Hail the King of Jews." They slapped him, spat on him, and throughout it all, Jesus remained silent. In Luke 23:11, it says, "Then Herod and his soldiers began mocking and ridiculing Jesus." Next element is we have the cross. Now, this cross was around 70 kilos. It was a rough piece of wood with splinters digging into the freshly ripped back of Jesus. And he had to carry this cross with the help of Simon for approximately 4 kilometers. Don't quote me on the numbers, but they're just the approximate numbers. But we still get a pretty decent picture of what's happening here. Why? Why did he do it? Why didn't he argue his case? Why did not he defend himself? With one word, he could have called out to his heavenly Father and God would have sent a host of angels to smite every single one of them. But he didn't. He remained silent. Why? Then we have the nails. These nails were 7 to 9 inches long, fashioned with heavy iron. The weight of a fully grown man was to be suspended by 3 nails. Hebrews 12:2, it says, "Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross?" Who for the joy? For the joy? He endured the cross. Like, was Jesus in his element? He willingly went. He didn't defend himself. He kept silent. He didn't try to escape. Like, seriously, the joy set before him, he endured the cross. Now, Jesus didn't think this whole experience was joyful. But what he did, he looked ahead. He didn't look at the now, he looked ahead. He looked forward to what was happening, the purpose of his death. Like, he knew and he understood that eternal life was for us all, that these elements were for us today. He suffered so that we could have freedom. He was in his element because he knew that our Father God wanted a relationship with us. He knew that he was the connector between man and God. He knew that he was making a way for us, for you and me, to spend eternity with him in heaven. He looked beyond the horrific event. That's how he was able to count it all joy. And that is how he endured the whipping, the beating, the crown of thorns, the nails, the shame of hanging on a cross, half naked, in front of everybody, mocking him. Now we go to the crucifixion. What happened on the cross means a great deal for us today. Now, if you're hearing this message for the first time, hang in there. I promise there's a good ending. I promise, you know, we're going to get to an amazing ending, or shall we say the beginning? The beginning. And you could be saying, can we skip to the good part, please? We're getting there. We can't read the last page of the book and hear this amazing, great story without knowing what actually took place to understand what is to come. So because of what happened on the cross means a great deal for us today, like it did all those years ago. Jesus hung on the cross in order to fulfill prophecy and to be a sacrifice to pay our sin debt so we could be forgiven and saved. Hallelujah. Hallelujah for that. Isaiah 53, verse 4 to 6, it says, "Yet it was our weakness he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion. He was crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's path to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all." Man saw the suffering of Jesus and didn't understand the reasons why. Why? Why all of this? Well, the cross represents the death penalty that Jesus paid on our behalf. Another element is you and me. Jesus hung on the cross and he saw all the things that has been done to you, all the things that you have done. Jesus hung on the cross and he saw the rapist, he saw the murderer, he saw the adulterer, he saw the gambler, he saw the drunkard, he saw it all. Jesus hung on the cross and he saw you losing a child, he saw you losing a loved one. Jesus hung on the cross and he heard your medical diagnosis. Jesus hung on the cross and he saw your pain, your sorrow, your grief, your shame. Jesus hung on the cross. He saw it all. He saw what's happening today, all those years ago. And as he hung there, he made a promise. And this promise was that he would take all of that upon himself and carry the weight of it and die so that we can be free from it all. He made a promise, and that was for you and I to know that he can take it all to the grave, bury it, and leave it there. He never promised life would be easy and that you would never experience some trials and tribulations, but he did promise is that he will walk with you every single step of the way. He promised that you will never be alone. And that for you to know that you are no longer separated from the Father, but you have eternal life. It's a promise of forgiveness. It's a promise of life, hope, and healing. And it's a promise of freedom. Hallelujah for that. Wow. So this has become such a sacred moment for mankind, a moment that Jesus went through, and all the pain that I just explained was for you, and it was for me. So it's so powerful when we personalize all that he did was for me, but I wasn't alive then, but he hung on the cross and he saw you. Saw me, hallelujah. Jesus of Nazareth, the Son of God, died for you and he died for me. He went through it all. When Jesus died on the cross, we get to see an amazing partnership between the Father and the Son. A love so strong that it defeated death for us. This has given us an invitation to be free from sin and death and for us to receive eternal life. God's Son paid the penalty for us and brought us freedom. I almost want to do that whole freedom. Yeah. The old, yeah. Mel Gibson. Now, this leads us to part three. Jesus died on the day that we call Easter Friday. But, I love that. There's a big but there. And this is a good big but. On the third day, we call Easter Sunday. What happened, guys? Jesus rose from the dead. Hallelujah. Yeah, come on. What a time of celebration. John 3:16-17, it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." So this is the word of God becoming flesh. Jesus showing such great compassion and mercy and love and forgiveness. Because of Jesus, we are saved. But what does this mean? All right, now we get to the good part. This is the good part. I promise that we're going to get there. Jesus rose from the grave and he's given us so many more elements. gave us life. In John 14:6, it says, Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. He is the light. Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. John 8:12. He gave us forgiveness. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and he is just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all wickedness. He's hope. This letter is from Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, appointed by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, who gives us hope. It's in 1 Timothy 1:1. He is freedom. So if the Son sets you free, you are truly free. The robe of righteousness. I am overwhelmed with joy in the Lord my God, for he has dressed me with the clothing of salvation and draped me in a robe of righteousness. That's in Isaiah 61:10. Next one is the anointing. And you know that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. Acts 10:38. He is Holy Spirit, for the Lord is Spirit. 2 Corinthians 3:17. He is the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 1:1. He is our bread of life. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. John 6:35. He is our communion. In Mark 14:22-24, he says, and as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and he gave it to them and said, take, eat, this is my body. Then he took the cup, and then he gave thanks, and he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, this is my blood of my new covenant, which is shed for many. So the purpose of all these elements on the table is to bring us revelation. And this revelation is to bring us reconnection. Reconnection to the Father. This sacred moment we celebrate every year requires a response. Jesus died and he rose to life to get a response from you and from me, because a removal took place. Jesus rescued us and he returned us to the Father. So here we have our communion cups. And this is what we do every Sunday as a church family. We can do it in our own private time at home. And the reason why we have communion together as a family is to remember all these elements that took place. Not just to celebrate it on an Easter weekend, and we have communion once a year, but this is a daily reminder for us, because I don't know about you, but life gets hectic. Life throws us some pretty full-on curveballs. And this, to me, reminds me I can do it. Jesus hung on the cross before he died, before the stone was rolled away from the tomb, before we saw him alive, he declared on the cross, it is finished. So the wafer in here represents his body, and the juice represents the blood that was shed